WWW dot Plymouth Congregational dot org and clicking on the donate button. You're welcome to make use of the family of worship room just outside the sanctuary. Services broadcast there. Thank you to those who provided drinks, Paula and Donna, and for being greeters. Join us for refreshments after worship in the East Room. I have a couple of announcements I've been asked to make. Does anyone else other than for Slimers and BBS have an announcement? Janet? Start looking for volunteers for a cruise night when we have special events that we're going to have flyers. So I have flyers for BBS, so I'm looking for some volunteers to come Tuesday night. I can't get here till like 5:30, 5:15. So Tuesday night, weather's good, we can pass these out, just walk around and pass them out. That's about all I'm asking. So just see me if you can help me. And along the line of BBS, announcement. BBS starts on Wednesday, July 3rd at 6:30 to 8 p.m. Theme for this year is Christian Olympics, where we will learn how to run the race that God has set out for us. All games are more fun with more people, so if you have not signed up your child yet, it's not too late. You can register them today before you leave on the paper registration forms like this. They're out in the narthex. And they can also go, you can also go to the website, www.plymouthcongregational.org, and register there. Today after the service, there will be a short meeting for anyone who is helping with BBS in the adult Sunday school room. Any questions? See Debbie. And then, come join Plymouth Congregational at the Joliet Slimers Day. It will be Sunday, July 21st. At 1:05 p.m. Plymouth will also be hosting the 50-50 raffle, so please sign up. We have opportunities for both walking and sitting to participate. We will have shifts so you can enjoy the game. We also receive the profits from the raffle. Tickets are $10, which $5 comes back to PCC. Order forms are in the narthex, in the East Room, and on the PCC website. Ticket orders must be received by July 1st. Any questions on this, please contact Beth Kaiser. All right. Any other announcements from anyone? Seeing none, then I'll proceed to the scripture. Now we ask you, brothers and sisters, to acknowledge those who work hard among you, who care for you in the Lord, and who admonish you. Hold them in the highest regard and love because of their work. Live in peace with each other. And we urge you, brothers and sisters, warn those who are idle and disruptive, encourage the disheartened, help the weak, be patient with everyone. Make sure that nobody pays back wrong for wrong, but always strive to do what is good for each other and for everyone else. Rejoice always, pray continually, give thanks in all circumstances, for this is God's will for you in Christ Jesus. Do not quench the spirit. Do not treat prophecies with contempt, but test them all. Hold on to what is good. Reject every kind of evil. May God himself, the God of peace, sanctify you through and through. May your whole spirit, soul, and body be kept blameless at the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ. This reading is taken from 1 Thessalonians chapter 5, verses 12. 23. Please stand and proceed with our opening hymn, Joyful, Joyful, We Adore Thee, number 20.
Amen. God, we joyfully offer up to you our praise and thanksgiving for your protection, your love, your grace in our lives today. And Father, as we gather here, we want to remember, Father, this service, that God, you would truly, without any kind of thought, that God, we would offer you praises of thanksgiving and joy. Now, our God, we ask that you would be in the service with power and strength. Teach us, touch our hearts. And God, let us all step aside and allow you, Holy Spirit, your perfect way. Teach us, guide us, open our hearts, open our minds. And God, in our spirits, let us rejoice in thee. This we pray in Christ's name, everyone said. Amen. You can be seated. I'm sorry. I'm trying to... Think I'm getting older, maybe words closer to me, but I'm going to put it down here. But today, how many of you know the song, "This Is My Story, This Is My Song, Praising My Savior All the Day Long"? Awesome. You all know that song, right? How many of you know this song? Jesus loves the little children, all the children of the world. What's the rest? Red, brown, yellow, black, and white, all are precious in His sight. Jesus loves the little children of the world. He even loves us old people. I'm glad for that. I am so glad. Have you ever watched kids play? I mean, little kids. I don't mean kids that have gone to school or kids that are 4 and 5 years old. I'm talking about little kids. You put a whole bunch of little kids in a room and they just have a good time. Wouldn't it be nice if us adults could do that? I mean, truly, wouldn't it be nice if a room full of adults could have a joyous time? Bill, no. No Jack Daniels, no vodka. I know him too well, right? But every one of us, remember the song we started out with? Not the opening hymn, but the song, you know, "This Is My..." How many of you have a story? Everybody's got a story. Jesus does love all the children, and not only the children, but us old people too. But all the people of the world, red and yellow, black and white, they are precious in His sight. Everyone can have a story. But all the people of the world, from every tribe, every tongue, every people, every nation, our scripture today is coming from Acts chapter 10. I'm using the whole chapter, so I'm not going to read it all. But please, if you have an opportunity, read Acts chapter 10 today. Or this week sometime.
Did I miss anything?
You can always catch up on YouTube. Is it a full moon? But today, I want to share some things with you. By faith in Jesus Christ alone, we can have a story. A story. I want to talk about Cornelius' story for just a moment. Peter himself comes to the same conclusion that everyone can have a story from Acts chapter 10, verse 34. He says, "I must certainly understand now that God is not one to show partiality, Does anybody here show partiality? Oh, yes, you do. Everyone in this room shows partiality over something. Whether it's the color of the shirt you wear, or the blouse, or whether it's the kind of car you drive, doesn't matter. You show partiality, don't you? But the Bible says that God shows none. It says, but in every nation, the man who fears him and does what is right can be saved. Now I know that term bothers some of us. Welcome to God. You'd think they would already have gotten the idea, don't you, the apostles? But here it is, Acts chapter 10. And they're finally learning that the Gentiles, these dogs of people, are just as precious as anybody else. You'd think they would have gotten it from Matthew 28, the Great Commission. Go ye into all the world and preach the gospel to only the Jews. Don't go to anybody other than the Jews. Because if you do, there'll be dogs coming in and eating from the table. Jesus said, go into the world and make disciples of all nations. How about his command in Acts chapter 1, verse 8? You shall be my witnesses in Jerusalem, Judea, Samaria, and the uttermost parts of the earth. But only to the Jews, of course. But they still didn't get it. It may be hard for us to understand what a difficult lesson it was for them to learn. The Jews were such an ethnocentric people. Do you know any other group of people that's that way? Methodists, Baptists, Catholics, Presbyterians. Y'all heard the story, didn't you? The Baptist went to heaven and being shown around by St. Peter and walks past here and he says, what's over there? St. Peter said, be quiet, be quiet. He said, what's the matter? He says, those are the Lutherans. They think they're the only ones here. Now, I'm not throwing anything at Lutherans. Please, don't take it that way. But are we all not that way? Do we not have partiality? If we had a, James been to a Pentecostal church, if we had a Pentecostal group come in here today, some of you'd be absolutely livid. Oh my goodness, look what they're doing. Or if we had a band on the platform today, some of us would be going nuts. Especially if they had drums. Well, thank God Bob's not here today. I got to pick on him. He's not here. You see, the Jews were God's chosen people. And everyone else was just plain dogs. It took a dream. And that dream was where Peter was hungry. And he said to those who were in his house, I'm hungry. So he went up on the roof to meditate and pray while they went and got their food. They ran down to Wendy's or McDonald's and they got, you know, a happy meal for Peter. I think they probably got the fish sandwich, but you know, it wasn't. So as Peter's on the roof contemplating, the scripture says that surely he had gone into what they call a trance, or he was in the spirit, or he fell asleep, or he had a dream, or maybe a nightmare. But he had it three times. And each time he had the dream, it was this great thing like a sheep being lifted down. And in it were all manner of animals, clean and unclean. And God said to him in his dream, Peter, go kill and eat. And he said, no, Lord, I'm a Jew. Don't you know that, God? I've never eaten anything unclean. I guess they didn't have a 5-second rule back then. Understand this, in verse 45, he says, surely no one can refuse water to these who are baptized. Why was that such an important thing? In Peter's dream, he saw this incredible thing come down. It was filled with animals. God told him to eat it, to kill it and eat it. And he said, no, they're unclean. The Levitical law says, I can't even touch those things. Y'all just finished Leviticus. The Levitical law says we can't do it. So I can't do it. I want you to jump with me to verse 45. Surely no one can refuse those water who were baptized to receive the Holy Spirit just as we did. When Peter's in the book of Acts, he goes back and he talks to the Sanhedrin, or basically the elders of the new church, and he says, look, the Gentiles accepted Christ. They're filled with the Holy Ghost just like we are. And he said, that can't be right. So he reiterated his dream, spoke to them what happened, and they finally understood what God was trying to tell them. There's no difference. Red and yellow, black and white, all are precious in His sight. Jesus loves the little children of the world. Well, what was Cornelius' story? Cornelius was a devout man. You know what that means, don't you? He went to church every time the doors were open, went to prayer meeting, went to board meetings, preached sermons, did all those kind of things. He even gave tithe, and he wasn't even a Jew. Can you imagine all of this he did and was still looked down upon by the Jewish community? Why? Because he didn't have the right bloodline. You see, the thing that I want you to look at, A.W. Criswell wrote this. He was attending Baylor University in Waco, Texas, and he was pastoring a little church in South Texas. When some of the members were going through some old books, they found a Spanish Bible, and they said, Dr. Criswell, Reverend Criswell, he wasn't a doctor at that time. Reverend Criswell, what should we do with this Spanish Bible? Well, W.A. Criswell said this. Give it to the Mexican family that works on your farm. Okay, they did. They asked Criswell what to do with it. He said to do that. A few weeks later, that family showed up in their church. That Mexican family showed up in this pristine little white Baptist church. And the elders came to the pastor and said, Pastor, look. What are we going to do? They said they accepted Jesus and they want to be baptized. We don't do that in white churches, they said. They told W.A. Criswell. Let me read his exact terms. They came in with 6 kids. They told them that they'd read the Bible, accepted Jesus as their Savior, and wanted to be baptized. The deacon looked at Criswell nervously and said, you know, Pastor, it's just not done around here. White churches baptizing colored folk. That's what he said. I know I'm going to get censored from Facebook. I'm going to get kicked off of YouTube, the whole deal. But that's okay. Listen to what went on. Criswell said, it is now. What? It is now. We're going to do it. Somehow, by the grace of God, these dear people found Jesus as Lord and Savior through the Word. And that same Word commands us to baptize them in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. And what the Bible says, listen to these words, we will do. What the Bible says, we'll do. I bet that raised some eyebrows in that little old town in South Texas. Unfortunately, too many of our churches have not gotten the memo yet from God. Sent in Acts chapter 10. The gospel is for everyone. We've seen this all over. All over. God welcomes all of us, regardless of who we are. The rough Samaritan half-breed woman. The hardened Philippian jailer. Confessed violent criminals hanging on the cross next to Jesus under the penalty of death. He was going to die. How much clearer could God have made it? The gospel is for everybody. But you know, we get this elitist attitude. We get this elitist attitude. Now I wanna do something for a moment. It tells us in John 6:37. The one who comes to me, I will certainly not cast out. 1 Timothy chapter 2, verse 4 says, God desires all men to be saved and to come to the knowledge of the truth. Now, I want to stop at that point, and I'm going to explain a term to you that maybe over the years I have expected and thought everyone knows the idea of it. When I talk to people about being saved, I see some people just do this. Saved from what? What you talking about, preacher? Well, here's what I want. I want to solve this issue right here and now. A lot of times people hear that word and they think, well, I'm not bad. I'm okay. What does it say in Romans 6:26? All have sinned and done what? Come short of the glory of God. Does that mean you're a violent killer? No. Does that mean that you're a liar? No. Does that mean that you're an embezzler? No. Does that mean that you're an adulterer? No. That means that someplace along the line you have not done the will of God. Does anybody here raise their hand and say, I have never sinned? Notice his hand went down. I'm not talking about bad people. I'm talking about good people needing to know the Lord Jesus Christ. I'm talking about people who were raised in the church and they don't know yet that they need to have a personal relationship with Him. Not go up and shake the hands of some preacher. Not put your name on a book. Not write it down. But have a personal relationship with God through Jesus Christ. That's all salvation means. Salvation doesn't mean you're a wicked, bad person. How many times have you heard my testimony and thought to yourself, boy, I'm glad I wasn't there. I'm glad I didn't do all them kind of crazy things. You don't have to do those to have a story. Listen to the story of Cornelius. He was a devout man. He had devotions. He read the Bible. He gave tithe to the church. He served God. Yet he didn't have the understanding of relationship. He only knew what to do physically. His life was wrapped up in his works. Salvation is not from good works. I want you to understand this. It's important that we realize the man Cornelius had all kinds of good works, but those works had not saved him. Something was missing in his relationship with God. Look at all that he had done. It says he was a devout man, feared God. That meant that he, although he was not a Jew, he served God in everything that he did. He gave many alms. He supported the church. It'd be like here if Bill Gates would somehow find that we needed some support. And he wrote us $1 million check. That $1 million check isn't going to get him into heaven no more than all the good things that he's done as a philanthropist. The only way we make it to the kingdom of God is through Jesus Christ, and that's a relationship. That's not a membership, that's a relationship. You see, he was a very religious guy. How many of y'all would say you're religious? I couldn't even raise my hand to that. I was at the racetrack last night. Somebody said to me, "Hey, you're one of the pretty good religious people, ain't you?" I said, "Who are you talking about?" I said, "You should have been in my car driving down here with all them people in front of me." The other day I was in Crete, Illinois. I had a meeting in Crete. And I decided instead of taking 80 and put up with all that traffic, I'd take Laraway. And I'd zip right across Laraway. I'd get to Brandon Road, scoot across, go up, hit Martin, and come home. Well, all the way to Brandon Road was a wonderful trip. Just singing and praising God and having a good time. I'd turn on Brandon Road, go down there, get to the stop sign. There's nobody down at the... I'd come down into the underpass like a bat out of you know where. And I had to put the brakes on real quick because traffic was stopped. The bridge was up. And I'm in the overpass. And there's cars behind me. Now I can't get turned around because they got me blocked in. So for 40 minutes I did this. One lady even got out of her vehicle, took her kids all the way down to the bridge, walked. When the bridge started to go down, here she comes. I said, "Hurry up, lady, hurry up, hurry up, don't you know?" Hey, you should have been in the car with me. You see, the thing of it is, there are none of us righteous. No, not. You see, he didn't have a story of salvation until the angel appeared to him and said, "Hey, I want you to go. Send some of your guys and get Peter from Jerusalem and have him come here. And he'll explain to you what I want you to do." So Peter came and Peter did what Peter did well. Explained the plan of salvation. The plan of salvation, very simple. It's not anything you have to go to class for. You don't need a degree in theology. You don't need to go to Bible class. You don't need to go to Bible school. All you need to do is say, "Father, forgive me of my sin." Have a relationship with God. Even though he was a devout man, he still needed to be saved. This is a mistake so many people make, thinking that they would be justified by their good works. "Oh, don't you know I did this? Well, I did that yesterday. Oh, my goodness, I helped an old lady in the door the other day. I volunteered for PBS." In the same way, Adolf Hitler, when he started the concentration camps, had a saying over the top of it. I'm not a German. I'm going to butcher this to pieces, but I'm going to try. Ardentnetfeuer! Whatever that is. What it really means in translation is, work leads to freedom. And that's a lie. That is a lie. There's no freedom for work. This one guard sarcastically told the prisoner, "The only way out of here is the chimney." Now I realize that it's not a popular thing to talk about the Holocaust. There's a lot of unpopular things that need to be brought out in church. Work at that particular concentration camp did not lead to freedom. It only led to death for thousands.
In the same way, the idea that your good works and deeds can make you right with God, that somehow work leads to freedom with God, is a lie. Notice all the religions of the world. All the religions of the world declare this. We're based on good works. People love the good feeling. I'm not trying to tell you, don't do good things, because good things do make you feel good. And doing good things is a good thing to do, but if you do the good things, do them for the right reason. I know. Good works can never make you right with God. No flesh will be justified by works, Romans chapter 3, verse 20 tells us. If good works could make a person right with God, the centurion would have been in. His name was Cornelius. But he wasn't. God had to send a messenger, an emissary, someone to go and take care of the deed. Genuine gospel message, because he knew that for all this man's good works, he was not reconciled. Most of us don't do what we used to do when we were first married. Yeah. How many of you still keep a check register and balance your checkbook at the end? Do you? Awesome. I'm proud of you. I kept the checkbook for about 3 months. We've been married 52 years come September. Does that tell you anything? Thank God for my wife's mathematical abilities. Salvation is only by faith. I want you to understand this. The first 2 points are wonderful, but this is very important. It's the greatest lesson of Cornelius' story. It shows how salvation by faith alone, unaccompanied by works of any kind. Look how the story unfolds in the second part of the chapter. After hearing Cornelius' introduction, Peter begins to preach. Just like you invite Bill around, Bill would start to preach, right? I had somebody say to me last night when I was walking out, "Oh, I heard your sermon. I pray." It wasn't a sermon, but to many people it was a sermon because it was longer than a minute and a half. Stop. Of him all the prophets bear witness, Peter said to Cornelius, that through his name everyone who believes receives forgiveness of sin. Then look in verse 44. I want you to see how wonderful God is. In verse 44, Peter's talking, and it says, while he yet spake, the Holy Ghost fell upon Cornelius and all of his household. In the middle of the greatest sermon in the world, the Holy Spirit comes down and stops the sermon. I know somebody's saying, come Holy Spirit, quickly. It's all right. It's so important. Peter was wrapping up his message, but he was not quite through yet. You know how that goes. I'm going to close now, and 20 minutes later, I'm closing. Stop it, Joyce. Peter was wrapping up his message, but he wasn't quite through. He may have been about to offer an invitation or to ask people if they wanted, you know, anything of the sort he may have been doing. But while he was still speaking, the Holy Spirit came upon Cornelius and those who were with him listening. The importance of this is that those people did not do anything. They didn't do good works. They didn't come to the altar. They didn't hear the message in its entirety. They didn't even have the Bible to read. But the Holy Spirit. Everyone who believes in him receives the forgiveness of sins. And they believe. Y'all remember what the word believe means, don't you?
Trust.
Everyone who believes in him receives forgiveness of sins. And they believe it, and instantly God saved them. He sent his Holy Spirit into their lives so that what happened now was that they were changed people. Salvation is not of any works. It's by faith. Faith in the heart alone. The Spirit came when he had nothing else but believe the message in their hearts. Believe the message in their hearts. This powerfully demonstrates the way God wants faith to work. I want you to know that some of the reformers, the people that we call reformers in theology, some of those people had it right. Faith alone. Faith alone. Faith alone. Only faith. Faith alone. Not faith mixed with anything else. Not faith and, not Jesus and, not something else and. Faith alone. The most important question of our lives, have you ever come to a time when you realized that your good deeds could not save you? Have you finally put your trust in Jesus Christ? If you have, then you're saved. I think it's very possible that some of you here today just realizing this for the first time. It's not coming to church. It's not being good. It's not writing a check. It's not how much money you have. It's not what color your shoes are. It's not what kind of car you drive. It's faith in God alone. Faith in God alone. I want you to know this. I'm going to close with this statement. The good news of this story is this. It doesn't matter who you are. It doesn't matter what color you are, how much money you have, or what your background is. If right now in your heart, you will repent of your sin and trust Jesus as your Savior, you will be. Without a doubt. Just as Cornelius did, just as the thief on the cross did, just as many of us have done before, you will be saved. Pray with me, please. Father, truly, today, I thank you, Holy Spirit, that you've had your way with this message. Certainly isn't what I wrote down. So, Father, I just ask you today to challenge every heart in this building. Every heart that will hear this message, be it on YouTube or listening now on Facebook. Or God hears it 100 years from now when somebody finds my notes buried somewhere. Today that they will trust you. Pray this in Jesus' name, everybody said. This time, we sing page number 72.
Thank you. Hallelujah.
Praise the Lord, praise the Lord, let the people rejoice.
Time for us to receive our morning offering. Would the ushers come forward, please, and we will receive today's offering. Thank you, Father, for this place to gather. Thank you, Father, for such a great and awesome nation that we live in. And God, we pray today that you would bless America, but God, in return, that we would offer praise and thanksgiving and blessing to you, our Creator, in whose name we pray, and everyone said,
amen.
Thank you. Please be seated. In the meantime, we will sing page Near to the Heart of God. We serve you as a great, awesome, living God. And we know that our requests are heard. And Father, we know that if you hear our request, that, Lord, the answer is either yes, no, or wait. And so, Father, we just ask you in the power of your Holy Spirit and in the truth of your word, we offer these requests to you. We're in healing, financial miracles. We ask you to bring relationship miracles, healing, Father, in ways that we cannot even begin to believe. But above all things today, Father, we pray for your will to be done. And we pray together the way Jesus taught us how to pray by saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Praise the Lord. What an awesome, awesome group you all are. Well, let's turn to page 128. We'll sing a couple of praise choruses here, and then we have a ton of sharing.
Thank you.
Our God, we truly thank you for this day. We thank you for your word. We thank you, Father, for all the gifts, talents that have been displayed here today. And Father, I just ask that you touch our hearts with your love and your presence. And God, that we may recognize faith in you. No other work we can do. Faith in you. This I ask in Jesus' name, and everyone said,
amen.